So let's talk more about those differences in brain structure and functioning that may affect eating in autistic people. There's growing evidence suggesting differences in the development of the amygdala among autistic people. The amygdala does a variety of things in the brain, such as processing emotions and memories related to fear, hence its involvement in the initiation of the flight or fight response. It also appears to be involved in the interpretation of social cues and information. A current theory explaining why the amygdala may be enlarged in autistic people relates to the ways in which differences in sensory processing in autistic brains may impact the development of neurons, and as a result, then go on to impact the amygdala's growth and ability to transmit signals to other parts of the brain. While it isn't completely understood, we do know that the amygdala is involved in the perception of flavor, which is the combination of smell and taste. Notably, the animal models that we test these theories on, like monkeys and rats, consistently demonstrate food neophobia, which is fear or hesitation when presented with a new food. Typically, they demonstrate their hesitation by examining the food visually, engaging with it in a tactile way, smelling it, and/or licking it. This appears to be an evolutionary response that kept our ancestors safe in a world that had tasty plants that nourished them, as well as plants that could make them very sick or even kill them. Theoretically, animals that demonstrate fear of new foods will experience learned safety after taking tiny bites or licks and discovering that the food doesn't hurt them. If they enjoy the taste of the food, they will return to the food again and again. While this example describes an aspect of the behavioral concept of conditioning, it is important to note that the neurology of autistic individuals and the food environments they encounter are very different than those of animals in labs. Due to the autistic brain's desire for predictability, even a change in the label of a preferred brand of food can trigger food neophobia and cause the child to reject the food, even if the food is in the packaging is formulated the same way as it was before. And the sensory processing differences that can be associated with the autistic brain can cause the autistic individual to reject a previously preferred food for a variety of sensory reasons, such as a different visual presentation, others sneaking ingredients into it, and/or presenting the food in a different environment. Using animal models can certainly give us some insights into the human brain, but we must be careful not to overgeneralize those findings. In addition to differences in the amygdala, autistic brains may also demonstrate differences in the insular cortex. This is the part of the brain located deep within the temporal lobe. In a recent study, researchers sought to identify brain structure that may be involved in anecdotal reports of picky eating among autistic people. When neurotypical and autistic subjects were given a sweet solution to taste, autistic adults experienced increased activation of their taste response in a part of the brain called the gustatory cortex, which is involved in the perception of taste and flavor. As a result, the researchers hypothesized that heightened brain responses to taste and differences in the function of the gustatory cortex may contribute to selective eating among autistic individuals. So, understood in the context of preference for routines and sensory and neurophysiological differences, the deficits identified by researchers studying autistic eating make a lot more sense and reveal themselves to be more of a feature of the autistic experience rather than a pathological deviation from a poorly defined neurotypical standard. To demonstrate this further, let's talk about chicken nuggets. Many therapists cite that children prefer processed meats like chicken nuggets over real chicken, like a chicken breast, because they're easier to eat from an oral motor standpoint and that they require less coordination and effort for chewing. And that's definitely true. Quite a few children, both autistic and non-autistic, have oral motor weaknesses and differences that impact their eating. However, we must also acknowledge that existing as an autistic person in a neurotypical world can be exhausting. And I personally also often prefer foods that are motorically easier to eat because I'm just exhausted by the time mealtimes roll around. And many of our kids are too. But let's examine this preference for chicken nuggets further and beyond the idea that it's just easier to eat motorically. Let's consider how comfort in the predictable and sensory processing differences in the autistic brain can result in a preference for chicken nuggets and a particular brand of chicken nugget at that. Real meats are really unpredictable to eat, and they're something that I struggle with personally quite a bit and have for my entire life. I've even gone years at a time without eating any meat for this reason. A chicken nugget, though, is gloriously consistent in its internal texture, particularly brands like Tyson chicken nuggets or Wendy's chicken nuggets. A real chicken breast is not. If it is cooked perfectly, a real chicken breast yields meat that can be pulled off in thin strings. I peel these strings with my fingers or a fork while I eat because I can't tolerate the feeling of biting down on a chunk of chicken and feeling that resistance from the meat, particularly if it's overcooked. It makes my entire body shudder. This is a physiological reaction that I simply can't control, nor can I control my gag response that results after this unpleasant sensation. As an adult with a supportive partner and quite a bit of language at my disposal to describe this experience and self-advocate for myself, I've become more willing to try different types of chicken in a variety of contexts, and when I'm well regulated. This was a years-long process that continues to this day and will continue throughout my life. If I'm not well regulated, I'm probably going to want to eat something far more predictable and that I know won't make me shudder and gag. If I become especially anxious or distressed after a negative physiological response to a food like a chicken breast, it's probably going to take weeks or even months for me to feel ready to try it again. However, regardless of my level of regulation, I consistently engage in the same mealtime rituals that previous researchers identified in those studies that we talked about earlier. And I use these rituals to inspect any chicken before I eat it. I touch it with my fingers and peel it with my fingers or my fork. I often peel the entire piece of chicken apart and visually and tactily inspect it for lumps, hard pieces, fat, discoloration, and any other unpleasantness before I eat it. If I identify something amiss with the piece of chicken, there's a good chance I'll reject part of it, if not the entire thing.